Time traveling to the land down under. We're gonna talk. We're gonna talk with a couple of fellas that have a bunch of smooth criminals. With an opening line like that, it can only be time for the MythWits, the show dedicated to all things geek pop culture, drenched in absurdity and coated with sarcasm. Every week, we bring you the news and interviews from the Geekiverse. We do our damnedest to be funny, but there are no guarantees. I'm your host, Peter Bryant. Joining me this week, got a whole crew of them, Mike Kafis.
Good eye, mate.
Jack G'day. Ballard.
Crikey.
Doc Joe Sweeney.
Straight. Surprise.
Stuart McDermid and Ray Duell.
How you doing?
So Doc Joe, Stuart McDermid, and Ray are all part of the StoryWeaver game company. They create off-the-wall role-playing games and modules for popular titles such as Savage Worlds and Rapture the End of Days, and a new game we're going to talk about. We're doing something a little different this time, so I hope this goes over well. If it doesn't, bear with us. This is a bit of an experiment. They are live at a convention. So, hey guys, welcome to the MythWits.
Thanks.
So we're really happy to have you on. I interviewed you guys, Doc and Ray, at for the AetherCon. I guess it's a con. It's like an online con, kind of a podcast, sort of in a weird way, YouTube series. But at any rate, I had the guys on. I was talking to them. I really liked what they had, and I said, "Hey, you guys got to come on the MythWits." They were generous enough to say yes, but we have to record it at a different time because they're like 15 hours in the future. So, Hey guys, Jack, why don't you ask him what you wanted to know about what's going on in the future?
Hey, could you just tell us if there's anything else fucked up that our current president's going to do in the next 18 hours that we can break?
We're not a person who throws that. I'm sorry, I've had a gag order placed on me.
Could you give us some alt future? Because we've got alt news, alt history.
Everything's going to be all right.
Oh, Christ, it is alt future. All right, so anyway. No,
it is actually interesting to see, you know, the way the news is globally is playing this out and the way the American news is playing it out, because we also get the American news. And it is fascinating to watch this whole fascinating and scary and oh, you know, we actually started writing a game about alternate politics and what would happen if you had a diesel punk sort of ultimate ultra-conservative world setting. Very much Warhammer 40K, but from an American perspective. We stopped writing it because it made us a little sad. And then all of this started happening. So maybe we should publish it. Maybe it's the right time to get controversial again.
Either that or we stopped because it started coming true. One or the other.
Yeah.
Hey, we could do the American version.
The role-playing game.
We could do the American version of Mad Max, but it would be a documentary. What's that, Mike?
I think we're a little way away from that yet, thank goodness.
The next 4 years is a white paper for that game.
Right.
Maybe. We're not going to get into politics. Though.
No. We're a comedy show. We're just joking around. Seriously. The MythWits has no political agenda whatsoever. We're just fucking cracking jokes.
We love Trump.
I know what you're saying.
All right, alternate facts. Anyway, so you guys are at CanCon in it's near Melbourne. I saw that. What's the name of the area that you're in? The actual.
It's actually in our capital. Australia's really weird because when we federated, nobody could agree where we should put our centre of parliament, our federation. So they said all the different states were fighting over it. It's so Australian. So they said, I know, we'll create a new state which only has one city, which is circular. And runs around and around in circles, and that will be where we put our government. So basically, we took all of our politicians and we put them out the middle of nowhere and leave them there. It's awesome.
Joe, you know why they made it circular? Joe, you know why they made it circular, don't you? It's so that the politicians couldn't get out.
Hey, is it a metaphor for how the government runs?
Out of touch? Sure.
Yeah, okay.
In circles?
Yes. Just round and round. It's no different than anywhere else, I'm sure.
It's no different than anywhere else, no. Yeah. But it does they do run a great con here, and it's been running since I remember coming here when I was 13 years old. I'm now just turned 50 at the start of the con. So it's a long-running con, and it consistently pulls a massive crowd, the biggest in Australia. It's great. Great con.
Oh, cool. All right. Fantastic.
Sounds cool.
And hold on. Let me make sure this thing is doing. I still was doing. All right. Sorry. I got this. I got a bunch of stuff going on. I was checking on our channel here. I just want to make sure we're that we're live and we're doing everything we're supposed to be doing.
Oh, so we are broadcasting live right now.
Yeah, we. Yeah. I think we are.
In that case, I retract everything I've said. I love everybody.
Right,
I have
just, no opinions. I'm just checking to make sure.
I'll Trump.
Yeah, we're good.
Joe, right. Joe, can you put the camera and show them the hall? It's just behind.
That's a good idea. Well, yeah, while they're, sure, while they're doing sure.
Yeah. We actually got ourselves right smack bang in the middle of the entrance of the hall.
Okay, cool.
See, it's just pre-packed today.
And that's just one of two halls. Oh,
three halls.
Wow. And
it's funny because
seriously, must be about 50 or 60 miniatures games going on at once.
Yeah.
Easy. Awesome.
Yeah.
Good lord.
That's good. And is that the biggest con in Australia? Biggest gaming or?
We think so. Yeah, by far.
Is PAX bigger?
No.
No.
Okay.
So we're going to have to get in the camera. There we go. Cool. And I don't know if you can see the cosplayers walking past us. That's been fun.
Yeah, that I can see some of them. They're great.
So yeah, what would you estimate?
We set up a photo booth so that we could get all the cosplayers in. We've got some amazing photos.
Green screen and custom backgrounds and all sorts of things. Got a lot of people past the booth you otherwise wouldn't have.
Oh, nice. Good. It's a good plan. What's that, Mike?
I was just going to say, what do you estimate the attendance is going to be for this year?
We think, well, last year it was 4,005-ish. And it's hard to tell because it's open door. But what they've done is they've set a massive games library and people just walk in there, they pay their $30, they do matchmaking, and half of this hall is just basically board games of people sitting down casually. As you can see, people walking in with kids. It's very much a family day sort of activity as well as the traditional board games.
We really wish we'd brought the kids game. It's that big for families.
Yeah.
Which is really, makes it really different from a lot of other cons.
Yeah. So okay. we think probably about 4,200 this year, maybe through the door over the 3 days.
Cool, very good. Wow. All right. Yeah, it's one of those. All right, so you know, here we have so we have like Gen Con and we have Dragon Con, and they have like 30,000 and 50,000 in an unknown number. Like, you know, I think Dragon Con, they won't say, they won't commit to a number because they're afraid it'll get shut down because of fire codes and stuff, but. Mike and I go to one called Total Con every year, and that, Mike, what is that? Is that like 1,000 people-ish?
I think they get about 3,000, almost 3 to 4.
Is it 3,000?
Yeah.
But that's my favorite. I love that.
There's a big difference, though, isn't there, between a con that attracts, say, 3,000 gamers and a con that attracts 50,000 people, a large number of whom aren't really gamers.
Right. Yep. Yeah. I was just going to say that that's why we love Total Con, because it's you know, like 3,000 hardcore, it's just a gaming community. And I don't know, everybody there is really super nice. It's just, it's an awesome experience.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, we love getting, we love playing games as much as creating. So I do a lot of the small cons as well. I like to get out to, you know, the small city conventions and just run games. It's how you keep in touch. It's also where you get good ideas. We pinch all our ideas off our players.
Absolutely.
And are you guys getting a chance to play at all?
Yeah, I'm running demo games. We're all running demo games.
We've run about a dozen games, I reckon.
Yeah.
Demos all over the weekend.
Yeah. Slaughter, this new game that we're launching. It's the first time the public's properly seen it with cards and whatever. That's getting a lot of demo games, and we're also getting. It's really interesting. Normally, our games have been attracted into a more traditional gaming market. That's that, you know, 35, 55 age group. Young kids, teens, love this horror movie making card game. And also, on our initial sort of testing on Facebook, it's just going gangbusters. People just love that. The teens just love this game. So I guess that says something. We may have hit a new market for ourselves.
All right. Well, hey, let's talk about that. That's the first thing I really want to talk about after the convention. Is your game Slaughter? So tell us about Slaughter. What is it? So it's a card game, right?
Right. So look, we've taken a really interesting journey. We started obviously with more traditional role playing games like Rapture, and although Rapture's heavily narrative, Savage Worlds and so forth. But what we've discovered is that there's a growing interest in board gamers having narrative games.
So we've started experimenting with creating games that are much, you know, have a broader audience. I love horror movies and horror games because I'm a sick, twisted man. So we said, how would we create a horror movie game that would appeal to board gamers, would be really accessible, a gateway role-playing game?
Can I just say that? Yeah. So we've watched it happen here because this is this convention has a huge board gaming contingent, and things like Pandemic Legacy, which are really starting to sort of cross the boundaries between stories and more traditional sort of objective-based board gaming, are really, really popular. And we're coming at the same thing from the other direction.
Oh, yeah, wow. So basically, Slaughter is a game where, and the other part of horror movie, most horror role-playing games, I should say, is that everyone tries to hold on to their character. Now, Call of Cthulhu, your character might survive 3 or 4 adventures. That's not a horror movie. Horror movie is you take glee in watching the characters get killed off in horrible ways over the course of the story, very quickly. So what we did is we fine-tuned it so that the characters actually, well, the cast are just tiles that get put on the game board.
Tile.
And then there's the tile.
That's cool.
And then what happens is the players then get to select a number of cards for skills, flaws, talents. These are the cards here. These are the roughs. And so you'll build a character in less than 45 seconds. Bang. Then the GM gives you another card called the hook. And the hook is the thing that screws with everybody. They usually tie you into another character. So a classic hook in the adventure we've been playing is, you know what somebody did last summer. Tell them. Don't tell anybody else. Blackmail them. And you know that's how we get the tropes. But what it means is that no one gets overly attached to their characters. That you still role play the scenes and so forth, and you've still got a director, but it's fast. And if you are culpable in your character or another character's death, you get an experience point, and then that becomes the new that experience point makes your next character tougher, but also the hooks get more and more powerful. So as the cast shrinks and gets less, they get more powerful, much like Ripley in Alien. You know, she starts off in the original Alien movie, she's a minor character, and it's about halfway through, really. You don't see much of her. By the end of Aliens, she's running around strangling queens with a mecha suit. You know, so it's escalation of survivability. And it works really well. And so that's Slaughter in a nutshell. It's a fast-paced, very tropey story game that lets you make movie script of any genre in about... You play the game and we're playing it here in 45 minutes.
What we found over the weekend, too, is that, you know, a lot of people play themselves when they play a role-playing game. They basically just transpose themselves onto whatever template they've been given. When you're released from the burden of, okay, this is my character for the next 14 sessions, suddenly people are far more willing to play against type and far more willing to play against their own interests, which makes for a much better story.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Tell them, you're not meant to last very long. You're supposed to kill off your character. So they've got the context correct. When I first played a game like this, I didn't have that context. I was like, no, my character's dead. And here's another one. Another one? you set the context. You've got to set a context for a game that's completely off the wall so that they're playing it the right way from the start.
Yeah.
And that comes back to design rule number one. Who are the players and what do they do?
Who's your daddy?
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
Now, I think that's awesome. That leads to... So you can have games at home this way that are a lot of fun, that are pickup games, that you're still role-playing... But it's not a lot of time investment, and you get that experience that you have at cons. Like, it's one of the things I like about going to a con and playing is that I can sit down at the table, I can play a character, and I don't have to worry about the character surviving because I don't care. I mean, I want to survive as long as I can. I want to be as successful as I can be. But you know, ultimately, if I lose my character, it's no big deal. So then I'm free to like. Play the character any way I want to, you know. If I want to play a character, it's like, you know what? Kind of feeling like I want to play an asshole this time, right? I don't have to worry about the repercussions at the next game session when the other characters are all pissed off because I did something messed up. Or, you know, if I wanted to play like you know, maybe I want to play a female character or something else that I wouldn't feel comfortable doing on a long term.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, and what more, that'll stretch your boundaries in that regard too in long term games.
Yeah.
Right.
It'll make you a better role player overall, we think.
I think so.
And horror is a completely different sort of paradigm, because in horror movies, people have to die. If you're hanging on to your character, they're not dying. Nothing's happening. It's not a horror movie anymore, is it? It's drama.
Right.
So if you want horror, you've got to promote them to die. So if you're going to promote them to die, then you're not going to be hanging on to that character anymore. Yeah. Then you can have fun.
Ultimately, though, this is a part comedy game. You can't make these too dark. I much prefer Vincent Price to, you know, Saw. So these games are lighthearted, and especially when you're playing with the teens who've been coming through, the next generation of gamers, they come up with just the wildest ideas. We had one who, part of this adventure, and we're doing a limited deck just for the people who've been at CanCon, this convention, for the early adopters. Bloodbath Barbecue, it's this one. It's set in the Australian bush. People are turning into dangerous Australian animals like drop bears. And I said to one of the characters, right, you're turning into a monster. Name the deadliest Australian animal that you're scared of. And he said, box jellyfish. So in the middle of the bush, giant humanoid box jellyfish stinging people to death. It was, you know, I wouldn't have thought of that.
Oh, nice. That's good.
I got a quick question. Okay. I can jump in. My grandmother, it was from Perth, Australia, and she told me about drop bears, and it scared the piss out of me. And then she told me it wasn't true, that it was just a way to get kids to, like, eat their vegetables and shit. Is that true?
No, they're absolutely true, which is
Australian government website has drop bears on it.
Yeah, which is why, you know, the little World War One German helmets with the little spikes in them?
Yeah,
they sell really, really well here. If you're going to go bushwalk, they're
with us. Wow. It's good for the edgewise too.
Yeah.
Can you guys zoom in on his shirt? I love that Slaughter shirt. Let me see that shirt.
Oh, here we go. Oh, yeah. So this is the Slaughter shirt.
That's awesome.
Yep. And if you go to I'm going to do a plug here. If you go to www.slaughtergame.com, slaughtergame.com, where we always like to have extended play tests of our games. So prior to the Kickstarter, which should be next month, we're hoping to launch it, we're letting people get access to the rules in Google Docs so that they can comment. I'm going to be pushing out all the PDFs as well. Anyone who's on that early access program, we're only going to take, I think we've only got about another 200 seats for it, but they will get the full game for free, obviously just in PDF format. But what I'm really looking for is feedback, because we've got 11 different decks of cards covering 5 genres. There's a lot of content there, and we want to make sure that we know what sort of content people really want for the game. So,
That's good. Hey, Mike, you had a question. What was that? You were
before when you were talking about the kind of the ways that people were how it's encouraged to die in the game. I kind of like that, and I was just wondering, is there a way, or is there anything built in so that it actually can encourage people? Two awesome
it's
deaths.
The only way you can increase. The only way to advance is to die.
Okay, so like I was thinking.
Somebody else is dead.
Yeah, I'm losing voice.
Yeah, we lost you there, sorry.
Oh, I was thinking it'd be kind of cool if there was a way to be awarded, like I died a really awesome death, and then I would get points toward my next character even.
Exactly what happens. That's exactly what happens. So there's two mechanisms. When you have a death scene, we call it, if it's a cinematic death scene, you immediately get narration of that death scene. It's really important that the players who's killing off their characters are getting that scene. And then they get an experience point. That experience point makes their next character have a dice step in their capabilities, either their mind, body, or their soul. So they literally get a tougher character. But more importantly, I don't have the cards here, I should have bought some, but the hook cards, the cards the GM gets out, they get more powerful. So the only way to get the really, really powerful hook cards, the ones that are, you know, you must have X number of deaths or whatever, is to have your characters killed off. Oh, there's an example of the hook card.
Okay.
So that type of card gets increasingly more powerful. So you're encouraged. The only way to get the more powerful cards is to be engaged in slaughter. Nice. And you're absolutely right. And it is tricky. Usually it takes, if no one's ever played a game like this, normally it takes the GM working with them or the director working with them to kill off the character for them to go, oh, now I get it, this is fun, and the next thing you know they're absolutely gleefully doing silly things. You know, the noise from the chimney, I'm going to stick my head up and see what it is.
What's cool about it is that people who've never played an RPG before actually pick it up quicker.
Yeah.
And along with that, I believe this type of game is really, really important for us as a community because it's the next step into the role-playing after how to host a murder.
Yeah, that's the point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I can imagine that you would have like a stack of characters. You know, once people are really motivated, they'd have stacks of characters to just keep trying to kill off.
Yeah, so what you do for that, and you've got to control that. So what you do is every genre, we broke down, we watched lots of too many horror movies, I'm ashamed to say. But we broke down the different genres, and there's really only five core genres of horror movie. And a lot of them are mixes of those genres. So what you do is you grab your deck, and then there's a set of generic characters of archetypes for that type of horror movie. Now the director, the game master, can switch those up as much as they want. But typically you never actually have more than about 8 or 12 cast people that you care about in a horror movie. Very rare, and sometimes less. And so they all get put down on the table. This is both character creation and story keeping. So the cast is always on the table. The protagonists, the people who are the player characters, you know, who you focus on, the camera focuses on, they're just when the player grabs one of them and says, I want to be the ex-beauty queen psychologist. That's one of our characters in this game. And then you dump the cards on them. That's how you create your character. So one of the challenges that people have is you can kill off the extras to save yourself, or you can have your character die and then choose a new extra. But that cast is getting smaller and smaller, and the trope cards are getting less and less. So there is this balance that as you get near the end of the game, things start getting genuinely desperate. So that's really important, so it's not totally open-ended.
And you can have people who are out of the game and just watching because there's no more cast left.
Yeah.
Right. And you know what? And that makes sense because the reason why I think that is a fucking awesome, awesome element is that just like in a horror movie, as people are getting killed off, you know, and things are getting more desperate, people are trying to survive more and make less stupid decisions because from a game mechanics perspective, your pool is running out. But from, you know, a real life perspective or a movie or a story that you're telling, you know, they're getting more desperate because they're realizing, oh crap, this is, you know, we're exactly. Shit, we're in a horror situation.
It's funny you can say that because it's actually a hook card that says, I watch horror movies, I know what's going on, we've got to get out of here.
And they die. but it's important because these mechanics are not designed to simulate
reality.
Anything.
Right.
They're designed to drive player behavior.
Yeah.
And I find that good mechanics drive player behavior, and bad mechanics simulate stuff the players don't need to care about.
Oh, but you're a dirty hippie gamer.
I am a dirty hippie gamer. I'll wear that.
That's fine. That's
the other mechanic which is in here, which is actually quite important, we haven't talked about, is we have a fear mechanic. It's a fight or flight mechanic. As people, and it serves three purposes. As people see horrible things, they become more scared. And they become more fearful. When you are scared, you are better at running away and hitting things, but you start to get less capable of thinking things through, so everything else gets less. So it's a little mechanic that works. Very simple, it's on the character sheets, it's a sliding scale. But on top of that, every time you get fear, you run the risk of getting mental instability, getting a madness. And those madnesses range from really minor things like you're scared of spiders,
or a facial tic,
to really dangerous things such as your head explodes in terror.
Awesome.
But what that does is it means that by the end of the movie, by the end of the story, it's very likely that at least one of your characters is panicked and is just through sheer terror and survivability, you know, is going to be able to survive. Doesn't guarantee it because they're also doing very foolish things, but they're doing them out of desperation. That's a nice mechanic that helps to drive that feeling of claustrophobic, you know, your opportunity is getting less and less and less, but you're getting tougher and tougher and tougher to do it.
Oh, that's cool. That's fantastic. All right, so you got that coming out on Kickstarter soon, right? Because I have a couple other things I want to talk to you about before our time is up. So when does that come out on Kickstarter?
So I'm waiting for the feedback from this first batch of early release.
And provided I'm not getting anything like this game totally sucks and here's why, and they're right, it'll go out the end of February. We're looking at it. We also have to watch Kickstarter to make sure there's no games that are going to be very, very similar to ours that will blow us out of the water.
One thing StoryWeaver really well is listening to our fans. We take feedback from cons, we take feedback online. In another game, we've got a section totally devoted to the fans who come in and look at the pre-release stuff and give us all sorts of ideas. And their ideas go into the game because this game
is their game.
And it makes them part of it.
Right, absolutely. All right, so everybody, make sure that you go to slaughtergame.com to get the free download of this and check it out and give these guys feedback. It sounds like a really, really fun game.
Yeah, it sounds really awesome.
Yeah, I think I might be doing that. I don't know. If I have time. Oh my God, I'm so busy.
I'll run a game for you.
All right. So let's talk about Rapture. All right. I talked to you last time when we were
doing the off Ray. This is the thing.
Okay. Yeah, this is Ray is now our senior writer for Rapture.
Okay.
So I gave up. I wrote the core, and then he took over because he's a much more evil man than me.
Okay. So when I was talking to you guys at AetherCon, we were talking about all the different stuff that you did, and Rapture just hit me right between the eyes. I really was intrigued with that concept, just how much fun we could have with that. So why don't you tell everybody about what is Rapture and how does that play out?
Well, we've been refining how we describe our games, because as people walk past the booth, you've got to really hit the button to get them interested. And the easiest way I can explain Rapture is if you've seen the movie Event Horizon, you have seen a Rapture game.
Mm.
Event Horizon is pretty much a Rapture game. Small group of people go to do something, bad things happen, somebody gets possessed, that's a Rapture game.
Okay.
That's totally what it is. And, you know, they said the ship has gone to hell and come back and something's come back with it. That's Rapture. That's what it is.
Slaughter definitely has its heritage in Rapture.
Yeah. Right. So the system for Slaughter is modified from Rapture. Slightly different dice. The mechanics work slightly differently, but Rapture is like the granddaddy from Slaughter.
Okay. And you...
So we're actually working on print copies of Rapture. This is the core rulebook, which was having some print issues, but now it's just gorgeous.
Oh, look at
that. All the artwork.
Oh, man.
And then we've got another book coming out shortly, which is a world setting.
This book.
This is the one that I pushed Joe on. He pretty much gets something up and running and then goes, oh, I'm interested in something else now. I said, no, Joe, Rapture's got big. Come on, we've got to do this. And he's like, yeah, I suppose it does. And he went off, and a week later he comes back with a 78-page document. What do you reckon about this? And I'm like,
right.
Okay, so yeah, we worked on that hard, because when Joe writes things down, yeah, English is optional.
It's right. English is optional.
It's quite optional, but this is a print preview, so it's slightly different now. But it's just turned out beautifully, this book. I'm so proud of it. A lot of this artwork is Joe's.
Oh, nice.
Oh, wow.
And that is marvelous.
Send you a copy.
The book talks about what happened after the Rapture. It has a year's worth of news clippings about what's been going on Confucius. Confucius is the largest colony of Earth left, and it's really the only group of people who have any chance of doing anything about what happened on Earth. So they want to know Earth's stopped communicating. Something really bad happened. There was all these nasty video images, and then the communications got cut off. And all the communications through the human sphere, all the little colonies out there in space by themselves, was routed through Earth. And once Earth went, they had no more communications with each other. So they're isolated. They're alone. Something really, really bad's happened. They've lost their home planet.
Much.
Could have been aliens. Could have been, I don't know what it is. They need to go back and find out. That's the driver for the story arc.
Yeah. Right.
So that's what's really cool.
Imagine, so for the audience, imagine you're on a, because we talked about this for a while, imagine you're on your space colony, you're light years from Earth, completely isolated in every way possible, but you still got your communication with home and supply ships are coming and all that kind of stuff, and then you don't have any connection with anyone. You're on a planet somewhere, right? No connection with anyone.
Yep.
And it's not just Earth. You're cut off from everybody, right? And then the people that you get connection with when you finally do establish connection, if I remember correctly, ships coming in or anything coming in, they're trying to get you, but you don't even know that. Like, you don't know what's coming. Like, oh, look, a supply ship is coming.
Yeah. So here's the thing. You know, the sort of horror that's in Rapture is actually a much darker horror than in Slaughter. And it is really set on that idea that the worst evil that we have is not big horned demons and the force of Satan. It's actually the temptations that we have as humans. It's the pettiness. It's the murderous rage that lives in all of us. So a lot of the horror, especially the way that Ray writes, a lot of the horror deals with people going off the deep edge and doing stuff because they're getting scared. They're getting confused. They're trying to find an enemy, a blame. And of course, Satan, the forces of Satan, just love that. I mean, tempting people to do dumb things and be mean, you know, be horrible, awful to each other is absolutely perfect. So the game is really about that human horror.
You have to play it straight.
You have, yeah, it's best to play this game straight. It is. I find it gleeful, but I'm an evil person.
The dark side of human nature is the dark side of human nature. Describe it.
So it's an intellectual horror game, not overly intellectual, but it is grounded in very, very hard science, and it's grounded in authentic. I tried when I wrote the original game. I wanted to be very respectful and authentic to the Christian faith, and really. But I don't. What I don't say is at what point is the Bible absolutely 100% true?
Right.
So, you know, there's this hidden unknown about biblical intent, and so that's a really tough one. So it basically makes everybody sinners, which is awesome. So when they die, they go to hell.
So your intent wasn't to like to make any kind of insult or anything like that. You're using that as a source material.
To be honest, it barely touches play most of the time.
Yeah. So the idea that it is a pure what if. So the what if is, what if science goes in this direction and humanity can get out to the stars? That's the first what if. And that's actually a really likely what if. The tech in there, with one exception, is very, very authentic and hard tech.
Every couple of months, we look at things that come up on Facebook with I Love Science stuff, and it's like, Joe, they're working out gravity waves. Yeah, gravity drive's coming. Yeah, it's coming true.
Exactly. And then we said, okay, so what if the religious texts of Judeo-Christianity were true, 100% true? And I'm absolutely happy.
There's that bit at the end, you know, the bit that everybody doesn't like.
Right, yeah.
Yes.
Except Pence.
And so we said, okay, now what if you would take that and treat it as a horror movie?
Right.
And that's it. It's just three of these what ifs. And we have got, it's the only game that we have where we have got people who treat us like, you know, what do you call them? Fans. They follow us around to cons with T-shirts with our game on it. That we didn't sell them, so you know it's a huge honor.
Yeah, it's a group called Squadron 40, and they come to the cons to play these games.
Wow,
I've been
cool.
Writing a whole arc of adventures, there's seven in total, which are going to be published after this one gets out. And they fall at certain important points in the storyline. And they've been coming to help playtest these at the cons, and they say, are you running Rapture? We're coming. Well, come down to Canberra if you're going to run Rapture. We're coming. Right. We're going to be there. So
I feel like a rock star.
There's a certain nice. Type of person who can't
awesome.
Get enough of this stuff.
That's cool. That's fantastic. All right. So you have...
The level of religiosity is about the level of The Exorcist.
Yes.
So you sort of combine aliens with The Exorcist, and you're pretty much there.
Okay. Oh, that's all question. Awesome. Sorry, we didn't get that.
So, all right, so that's Rapture, and I love that concept. And I've looked through the book. You guys were generous and sent me some PDFs of it. And I was looking through it, and it's really cool. At some point when my group gets a break, I'm gonna pull it out. That's even worse. I'm gonna start an adventure, and I'm not gonna tell them anything about it. I'm gonna say, you know, you guys, because they won't know, right? I'm gonna say that we're gonna play a sci-fi game, and you guys are living on a colony, and these are the characters you're allowed to play. I'm not gonna tell them anything about what's about to happen, and I'll let the ball drop right then.
I'm gonna make a suggestion for you.
Yep.
Grab Transit to Perdition. I think I may have sent you that one. Because
mm-hmm.
that has about 300 meg of audio files, like a video game, you know, when you find a clue and it's the audio file, we've got some great talent, including this man over here, to record these different recordings from all of the staff who've been murdered before you arrive to give you clues of what's happening. And it totally changes the tenure of the table. The tension just goes...
I find when you're running horror, music in the background is really useful, like clunks and bangs when you're in an industrial facility, just stuff that breaks the flow of people's thoughts. That really messes them up and gets them into the horror mode. Yeah. And big noisy sirens that go off when the things hit the
you
fan.
You can say whatever you want. Hey, you can say whatever you want.
Can I?
Yeah, go ahead. Knock it out.
It hits the fan. Yes, it does that a lot in Rapture.
You know, or a big siren that goes off when your wife tells you it's time to stop playing.
Yeah, that one. Yeah, that one.
Yeah.
But sound effects are a big thing because we wanted to be a bit different from the people who just sell books. So with a lot of these things, we have downloads you can get with music tracks and soundtracks and
It's the whole immersive experience of gaming.
That's snippets. Yeah. It brings the computer game players in a bit more too because they're used to that sort of thing.
Oh, yeah.
So it sort of crosses and draws them in as well.
That's and if cool. you've ever tried props at the table, it's like super props.
Right. Yeah. And we do that. We all kind of have our laptops with us. We don't really use them that much. But, like, I bring one, and I know another guy brings his. It's sort of a backup case, like, the DM forgets to print out the character sheets or whatever. I always have a copy on my computer. I can look at that. But, yeah, so there would be no big deal to bring a computer and play these sounds. Like, okay, well, you guys are looking around, and one of the guys might say, well, I'm going to try and get the computer working, and, all right, so you break in, and here's what you hear, and then play it, and, like, watch their faces and be like,
what they also don't need to know where you got the sounds. You are the god of prep.
Yeah.
Yep. Well said.
Yeah, thank you.
And I'll often use the sound as a clue. And it's only the people who are actually listening who get that clue. Like, you get a heartbeat. And right. People who are sitting close to the computer might hear it. First of all, that's just background noise. I won't worry about it. And it starts getting louder.
Right.
And they're like, okay, maybe that's significant. It starts getting louder. It's like, okay, crap, something's happening here. What is it? And... they scare themselves. The right. best part about writing horror is when people scare the crap out of themselves. And you can also, being a narrative game, the GM's given a little bit of that control away, but it also gives the imaginations of the players a part in creating the story. It's not all the GM's imagination. It's all the other people as well. So when we do the narration of the scene after rolling the dice, they can throw in the bits that they find interesting, and I completely set them up. Like, there was this one scene in a space station where they were sneaking around trying to break into the command section, and they ended up in this big, dark, open space. They could hear the echoing. And the door slammed shut behind them, and then lights came up, music came up, and it was like a gladiatorial ring.
Oh, that was just dumb. That was just crazy.
It was great.
It was crazy
because I said the guy announces that you're going to take on this genetic mutant, and the door opens at the far side, and you see your turn to right. Mm-hmm. And you just sit there and wait for them to scare the shit out of themselves.
So the characters, the characters are actually much better at coming up with monsters that are going to eat them than the GM.
Yeah, always.
You just never know what they're going to come up with. It's just, it surprises you too. So right. you get some surprise.
Yeah, we have a rule at the table. One of the rules of the table is be careful because there's the game master can play off of anything that you say, and we often do. So it's like, you know, when somebody says, oh God, I hope that's not one of those, it's like everybody else is like, shut up, he might use it.
Just give the GM chocolate, please.
Yeah, exactly. All right, so again, we're running a little bit on time. You have another game, High Space. Can you tell me about High Space real quick?
Why don't we talk about Deniable, because Stuart and Joe wrote that. I'll go and grab Pat for High Space while you're talking to them about
it. We need to leave somebody manning the booth, and that's our station.
That's all good.
Deniable.
Okay.
What do you want to know?
All right, so Deniable, I saw my brain's fried. A spy type game, right?
It is. It's comedic, or at least satirical. I reckon the best touchstone for Americans is probably The American Office.
Okay.
That kind of humor.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Possibly a bit darker than the American version of The Office. But, definitely along those lines. I wanted to create a game that could be played in adult time. There's a lot of games out there that require enormous amounts of prep, and you're expected to be, you know, 17 again in your mum's basement, you know, with 3 days to play.
Right.
I wanted to make a game that could be played.
I remember
in,
that episode.
Yeah, it was great, wasn't it?
Was
we all miss it. We all miss it, and we'll never get it back. So I created this game so that people could play a show in 2 hours. And I went with show because, you know what? These people are used to getting their entertainment from television. A television episode has a whole bunch of time-saving devices in it. Things like scene setting, things like cutting away, you know, things like just purely visual scenes. And if you set the show like that, you can end up with something that takes a lot less time and still tells a good story.
Yeah, yeah.
So these people, undeniable, are really normal people. Really, really normal.
Or they're less than normal. They're, you know, they're
somewhat below average.
Below average,
yeah. Right? So you've got a mundane job and a mundane hobby, and
we did have one character who was a shop clerk in a Warhammer 40K store.
We did have a shop clerk in a Warhammer 40K store. So we're talking pretty mundane. And so this game plays out in scenes, but what makes it special is that one of the tropes I really don't like in your average role-playing game is that regardless of what the characters would do, they often artificially stick together. And you end up with this really weird thing where there's this guy trailing around after other people who really shouldn't be there. You know, they should be off doing something else. But everyone has deliberately sort of made allowances for that so that the game can go on. Mm-hmm. So what I did was I took some of the NPCs, in fact, the most important ones, out of the hands of the GM and put them into the hands of the other players. So if Joe, Ray, and I are playing, then Joe might play my wife, and I might play Ray's husband, and that kind of thing. So what it means is...
But when I'm playing the wife, I'm the extra, I'm the NPC.
Mm-hmm.
You're then definitely there playing for the PC, but you're involved in more scenes than you're not. And whilst the game is about being a spy, it's actually the family scenes and, you know, dealing with real life whilst you're trying to work for a shadowy organisation that steal the show.
So think of it this way. There was one scene where a character is given what is clearly a bomb and told to get it out of the city. And it's a suitcase. So they take the suitcase and drop it down the well at this farm. And the guy says, "What's in the suitcase?" "Oh, don't look at the suitcase. Don't just get it out there before 11 o'clock. So he takes a suitcase, he starts driving, a clueless taxi driver, and then he gets a phone call from the school, and it's like, "Dad, my boyfriend dumped me, can you come and pick me up?" And so now he's going to deal with his daughter and the bomb, and, you know, it's that sort of absurdist humor.
Absurdist humor, yeah. The other thing about the game is that I despise prep, like on a...
He's lazy.
On a universal scale. Lazy. I'm doing this for fun. I don't want to play the game before I play the game.
Right, yeah.
It's work, not that. The GM is not allowed to prep. It's an explicit rule in the book. You're just not allowed. You prep by rolling on a table that tells you who they're going to meet, what the job's going to be, where it's going to happen, and who or what the complication is.
Right.
And part of the challenge for the storyteller, the director in this case, is to tell a story within those constraints.
Ah, okay.
So, yeah, that's the novel. And it plays, what I like about it from my point of view, is it. You will finish a game of Deniable start to finish in anywhere from 45 minutes to an hour and a 15, and it plays beautifully online. So I wanted a game, and I found we all get really busy. And if you can connect with your friends, especially when they move in a state or even overseas, with something like this, it just nails it. And it's a fun, you do end up laughing until you cry with it. So that's worked really well for us.
That's cool.
That's really cool. Yeah.
All right, so you got...
Now, we do have Pat.
What's that?
We have Pat here as well, just so that you know.
Okay.
That's all right.
Pat's our hype man.
And Pat does...
Hey, guys. Oh,
and I'm sorry, Pat, what's your last name?
Taylor.
Tyler. Pat Tyler. Okay.
Pat Taylor.
Taylor.
Okay.
Taylor.
Taylor. Got it. Yeah. All right. Yeah. So, so Pat, what did you...
Bye,
work? Taylor. Pat, what have you... what was your... what did you work on?
High Space.
It's okay,
actually
great.
Savage World.
Fantastic. All right, let's talk about High Space then.
Yeah, it's completely different to what these dirty hippies have been doing with gaming. I love Deniable. I've played Deniable, I've got to say, a couple of times, or more than a couple. I love it. It's fantastic. Rapture and Slaughter as well. The storyteller kind of vibe in the game is amazing. But Savage Worlds, yeah, well, High Space is Savage Worlds. It's a fully licensed product. It's in version 2 after being out for about 3 years commercially. Did really, really well in PDF format. Hopefully the physical book version 2 is going to do just as well. I actually had a – you dragged me away from a conversation with another games designer, Mecha Strike.
Oh, yeah?
Yep. And so we were talking about mecha rules for
– I want to do mecha rules for – I've wanted to do them for ages. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway. The core idea for High Space, this new iteration, is we've taken it from being just a little part of the galaxy.
I love this.
Yeah.
Hippies not required.
Yeah, hippies, like, so now what we did is I worked on a lot of fluff with
he's good at fluff.
I'm good at fluff.
You're a fluffer?
What we did is we said, what if you had sort of like a Star Trek like Federation, but much larger, higher tech. But instead of the Prime Directive, they have something which we call it the Doctrine of Least Resistance. And it's they find a planet of species. Maybe they haven't got space travel yet. Doesn't really matter. And they say, hey, would you like to join us? And they say, oh no, thank you. We like our independence. They go, no, we'll genetically re-engineer you and uplift you so you'll live longer and you'll be happier and we'll give you lots of great tech. No, we like our independence. No, you really, really want this. You really want to be genetically re-engineered so you're not as aggressive as you currently are and join us. No, we really don't want to join you now. And then they send in the player characters. So it is a utopian. It is a utopian universe society. You will do it our way or else.
It's sort of like the anti-Prime Directive, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
If you've read it in Banks, it's contact, it's extraordinary circumstances. It's that kind of vibe. In fact, we've taken the whole, we've bound the setting with the Savage Worlds rules incredibly. Like in the first version, I bound the Bennies and the Benny economy into the rules and the setting in terms of like probability kind of war sort of thing. You can lose Bennies, other monsters can steal them. And in this one, we even went the whole hog and we got permission from Pinnacle and literally the concept of wildcard isn't just now a rules mechanic. It's actually a part of society. You're playing a wildcard in society.
You're playing a genetic throwback. So everyone's been genetically engineered to be passive and happy and cheerful, but there is a very, very small 0.002% of all alien races that have been uplifted into this human society and human. Well, we're aliens too, really. We're the most alien. but there's a tiny percentage that just are genetic throwbacks. And that's you. That's the player character. Because you want a bit of violence.
So hold on. Yeah. You're not just this meta character that's a wild card. In society, you're essentially a wild card. Like, people refer to you as whatever the name is for the genetic throwback.
Wild card. No, as wild card.
The name is wild card.
Yeah. Awesome. And
that's the permission from Pinnacle.
Yeah. And by the way, it's not a term of endearment. You're considered...
Well, there's like also knuckle draggers,
right?
Knuckle draggers,
Dewclaws, throwbacks.
Yeah. So you have there's a lot of insults thrown at you, but you don't care because you can punch them and they'll be too scared to punch you. So it's great.
So you're the misfits and the mercs and basically going around protecting this future utopia in space, doing dirty deeds.
Yeah. So the big thing with the utopia is they think they're incredibly powerful. They've been around, some of the races, and they've been around space traveling for about 10,000 years, but the site itself is about 5,000 years old. There's civilizations out there which we're just starting to encounter that are billions of years old.
Right.
And there's a lot of bad stuff coming their way, and they're only just starting to realize it. So you've got the whole big galactic war brewing, you've got lots of internal politics, you've got all of that space. So it's
very big.
It's almost
too big.
Almost too big.
You get what you pay for, 240 pages or something like that.
Yeah, we've got about, I think it's almost 20 playable alien races plus the ability to make your own. Lots of, it's your classic big operatic sci-fi.
Cool, fantastic. All right, and one last thing real quick. I want to mention, how do you pronounce this? Hail?
Hail. Awesome. Hail, yeah, hail. I years ago for D20 I wrote Psyhammer, Psionics rules for D20, and did pretty well. They went to Copper Pick, I think, on RPG Now. And I had a setting, which was basically this one, and Psionics, and it was fantasy, as well as Psionics. It had basically in the big war between the orcs, the humans, and the elves, the orcs won. And you could still play humans if you want, but they were the feral outcasts, and so were the halflings. Dwarves were all killed, of course. There you go.
And I like the fact that the halflings became cannibals and rode hyenas. That's a game.
The folk society was, the folk society was orcs who had evolved pretty much into Romans. And everyone else was their slaves. So, but it was cool, yes, and there were aliens.
There was other weird stuff going on. Lots of psychic, blood magic.
And it is my favorite fantasy setting still.
Cool. and rumor has it it's tied into something else apparently or something, right? And maybe
one of the big bad alien races in high space is actually the same as one of the aliens that ended up actually two alien races who have invaded onto Hale.
So it looks like that Hale is probably set several hundred years in the future of high space on a fantasy world. So
but you'll have to buy both of those games to actually find out how that works. So buy both of those games and then maybe you'll find out, you know.
Well, if you say so.
Yes. And all the supplements. Buy all the supplements.
right, absolutely. All right, so hey guys, I want to give out the links. So and I want you guys to stick around for can you stick around for just a few more minutes?
Sure. Yeah.
So, okay, because I want to, Mike, I know normally you do the game, but I know we didn't prep one, but I got a game we can play real quick. It'll only take a few minutes. But before we do that, everybody, make sure you go to StoryWeaver.com. I've seen their product. They sent me a bunch of the PDFs. It's awesome. Very, very cool stuff. And if you haven't been convinced by now, I mean, come on, what's wrong with you? StoryWeaver.com. Also, make sure to check out Slaughter Game. .com for the playtest and the Kickstarter's coming in February, end of February, hopefully. And then their Facebook page is StoryWeaver Games, so Facebook/StoryWeaver Games, and on Twitter they are at StoryWeaver RPG. Is there any links I missed? Anything else you want people to check out?
There is also Instagram, which is StoryWeaver Games as well.
Okay, fantastic.
You know, we've discovered that people don't like to read anymore because it's too depressing, so they just look at pictures of games and cats. I love it.
All right, so hey guys, I want to play a game with you guys real quick. So because we like to have people come on when they come on, we like to play a game with them. We're gonna do a quick one.
Is it a drinking game? I actually wrote a game for this weekend on the back of our flyer. It's about four paragraphs long, and it's designed to teach non-role players what a role-playing game is and how to make one.
Well, this is sort of a betting game for us.
Betting. I'm in that.
So what we're gonna do?
Because we're Australian.
We're gonna play. We're gonna play my game, Cube of Death. It's an RPG trivia game. So how this is gonna work? I'm gonna ask you guys a question. Now the three of you can put your heads together. So I'm gonna ask you a question, but don't answer and don't try to. I need your poker face. You need to give us a poker face because we're gonna bet on whether you know it or not. We've just talked to you for almost an hour, and we should know you pretty well by now. We should know your geek cred by now. So, Mike, you and Jack are going to bet on whether these guys know the answer. So I'll ask you the question. Okay. Don't answer. Let me, Mike, and Jack make our bets, and then you guys can give us the answer. Now, we're not going to bet on the answer. We're just going to bet on whether you know it or not. All right?
Got it.
Bet the Geek.
It's called Bet the Geek. That's our game. So hold on. Let me, I made the wrong thing over. So let me, I'm going to switch over to that on, there we go. So Mike, I had this all prepared. I actually did this. So, all right. So guys, we're going to play Bet the Geek. All right. And we have, Joe, who all's in? Hold on. Let me see. We got Joe. We got, Stuart and we got Pat, right? Okay.
Yep.
All right. So you guys are going to work as a team. So you got a big giant brain trust right there between the three of you.
We've never done that before. Are you sure?
Right. Yeah, and we might create a black hole. Who knows? All right. So here we go. Here we go. All right. So let me see. Let me.
I'm terrible. All right. I'm so bad at
Well, you got three of you guys, and you can talk amongst each other. I don't care. It's fine with me. Just let us do our bet first, because that way we don't get to hear your inner. All right. So do you guys want? Would you rather have a science question or a Discworld question?
Science.
All right. What does the acronym LASER stand for?
All right. Don't answer yet.
So Jack, I'm gonna start with you. What do you think? You think these guys are gonna be able to come up with this? It's gotta be exact.
I think the Australian education system far blows ours out of the water, and these guys all know what LASER stands for 100%.
All right, so Jack says yes. Hey Jack, so you're pretty confident. So one, two, or three? We're gonna start with all 10 points. Well, no, I mean just whether they get it right together in their combined brain or not. So you think a three?
Three, definitely.
Okay, so definitely three. All right, so Mike, what do you think?
I'm saying two, no. They do not know it.
Two. All right. You know, I'm with Jack. I really think the Australian education system probably blows ours out of the water right now. So I'm going to say...
When I was at school...
Was that?
That was a million years. Doctor of education. Yeah.
So I'm gonna say yes, but I'm not as confident as Jack. I'm gonna say yes for 1 point. All right, guys.
All right.
Go ahead and confer, and then let me know what you think. Give me your answer.
Light amplification. I don't know the S.
The emitted radiation. What's the S in laser?
What are the last two?
Emitted radiation.
Emitted radiation.
Light amplification.
Something
stimulating.
Stimulated emission. Yeah.
God damn it. You know what? I'll take it. That's close enough because it's light amplification by stimulated emissions of radiation. They get it right. Hot damn.
All right.
That was a real team effort. We got about two words each.
That's fine. That's
I got
that's
light.
All right.
Don't ask you to do the odd number first. All
right. So the next one. Let's see. I don't like that one. Let's do this one. All right. So Indiana, I'm gonna give you a choice here. Indiana Jones or astronomy?
Indiana Jones.
Indiana Jones.
I'm hopeless with astronomy.
Depends
how good you guys are at astronomy. I'll do Indiana Jones. I'm pretty good at astronomy, but I'll do Indiana Jones because we had a little kid.
Yeah. I would have been about this high,
made his own costume,
and came in cosplay and did an amazing photo shoot. So it's Indiana Jones
day.
For the Indiana Jones day.
Yep. All right. Dun, 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 dun. Now let us know what you think here, but until we ask you, what is the name of Indiana Jones's father? All right.
Dr. Jones.
Let's start with Mike. We'll go with Mike this time. What do you think?
I'm gonna say 2 points. They know it.
2 points. Okay, so yes for two. All right, Jack, what do you think?
I'm gonna bet against them. They were very excited to the topic, but when that question, I saw their faces kind of drop.
Damn it!
And it was kind of like, oh shit. So I'm gonna say
You're gonna say no.
Okay,
so how sure are you? One, two, or three? Jack.
Oh, two.
Okay. You know what? I'm going to go yes, and I'm going to say between the three of them, they'll figure it out. Fuck no. I don't know. You know what? I'm going to stay. Yeah. You know what? Yeah. I'm going to go yes.
It's harder when there's more of them, isn't there?
Yeah, I know. Isn't it? this is one of the versions. There is a version of Cube of Death that we run that has teams where the three can put their heads together. It does change the dynamic of the game. You get Jack. Remember we played last week. You get more right answers with three people. Totally. So yeah, I'm gonna say yes for two. All right, guys. So do you guys know who the father of Indiana Jones is? And I need his name.
Sean Connery. No.
Yes. No.
You're close.
I thought it was Cornelius.
Okay, we'll go for Cornelius. We're locking in. Dr. Cornelius Jones.
No, it is Henry Walton Jones Sr.
Oh, okay. Somewhere
I knew that. That's right, because he's junior.
Yeah.
So,
I want you guys to know there's no one in the United States named Cornelius. There's
Cornelius.
Here. I checked. Nobody here is Cornelius.
Don Cornelius.
No, that's a last name.
As a first name, as a surname.
Oh, okay. All right. So, we'll do two more. We'll do two more. So let's see. Let me do. Let's do. All right. Yeah. Let's do this one. All right.
We're gonna focus on his face only. So yeah, he's got our best poker face. Go.
Okay. So, do you want physics or Blade Runner?
Blade Runner.
Oh, okay, Blade Runner then.
Blade Runner? All right.
Neither of those.
Physics then.
Physics?
Okay, Blade Runner.
Blade Runner.
Or you can't play.
All right, Blade Runner. All right, Blade Runner it is. In the film Blade Runner, what was the Tyrell Corporation's slogan? So that the Tyrell Corporation was the corporation that made the symbionts. What was their slogan?
All right. Don't say anything.
All right, so Mike, you're volunteering to go first.
3 points they don't know.
Okay, so no for three. All right, so Jack, what do you think?
They don't know it at all.
Okay, three points?
I think we've actually got...
All right, so I'm going to have to... Using game theory, because Jack is so far ahead, I'm going to have to go with, if I stand a chance of winning, I have to go yes for three. I don't really think they know it, but if I want to catch up with Jack, I have to win this one, and I have to do it this way. All right, so guys, what do you think? What is their slogan?
Well, I think it's been 20 years since I saw it. I think that.
But no, the building
better hours?
The owls.
It's not. Would you like to know more?
Now you got me double. Not. No. It's not. Would you like to know more? No. Oh my God! I think we're actually confusing it with Alien.
No. You're Starship Troopers.
Starship Troopers. Whaling Corporation. It's Whaling Corporation.
I'll give you a hint. It's not this. It's not the Krusty brand seal of approval. It's not just good. It's good enough. That's not it.
Oh. It's better than you. Not just.
With me. I think we're guessing here.
I think we're down.
But let's guess.
Building better pyramids for the future.
No. Better than human. We're gonna go better than human.
All right. What is it?
You're so close.
Better than human.
What was it?
God, should we give it to him, Jack? That's so close.
No, so close.
No cigars.
Okay. Well, you said all right. It's goddamn. This is really fucking close, dudes. It's more human than human.
That
was good. That was a good guess. All right, so.
That was really good. I lost that. Oh, well. Let's see if we can redeem this one.
But that's my complaint, too. Some of these movies I haven't seen in 20 years, and it's like, who was the niece, that pet the dog for 8 seconds in this movie? And you're like, what are you talking about? You know what I mean? It's like,
Sharon. That one I know. That was Sharon.
Sharon, right. Sharon Peters.
All right, so we'll do one more just for fun. Jack is winning. Jack is going to win this one, but we're going to do one more just for fun.
Okay.
What are you geeking on? What is your thing?
Oh gosh,
it's a very different answer from
computational linguistics.
Now, what you said? You said alien, right?
Yeah, I'm an alien nerd. Bruce Campbell.
one of those cards from the computational.
I got a man crush on Bruce Campbell, so big.
Oh, really? All right. I have an Evil Dead one, but all right. So we'll do an alien one. All right.
You do Princess Bride. I'm done.
Yeah, Princess Bride.
Princess Bride. I got Princess
Bride.
We're
all for Princess Bride. Best movie.
My wife makes me watch that once a year at least.
All Pride and Prejudice.
Okay.
That I'd rather forget.
Here we go. Princess Bride.
Here we go.
When Wesley challenges Humperdinck to the pain, what body part does he say he'll allow him to keep? Jack?
I know.
Actually, I'll go first. No. Wait, did you say I'll know? You're not supposed to let us know that.
Well,
where?
He knows. So I'm going to say...
Wait a minute, now. He gave it away. I got to ask another one. Hold on.
No.
Okay. Yeah. I'm not even going to listen to the question.
This was a poker face guy.
Eyebrows, isn't it?
Eyebrows.
You can't do poker face.
Hold on. All right, let's do this. You guys got to know. All right, you guys are gamers. You got to know Lord of the Rings. All right, so let's do this. We'll do this one. All right. What color was Radagast? What color wizard was Radagast? All right, Jack, what do you think?
They have to know this.
Okay. So yes. Three. For what? Three? All right.
Three.
All Mike, three. What do you think? No, I'll go. You know what? I'll go next. I've been going last every time. I'm going to say... Again, I'm going to say no, just because I need points for three. All right, Mike?
Could you repeat the question?
Yes.
No, what color? Take a shot at
what color wizard? Because every wizard in Lord of the Rings has a color. What color wizard is Radagast?
I say 5 points. They know it.
So yes for three. All right, guys. What do you think?
Who said the wrong answer just to screw them up?
Yeah, let's prove you all wrong.
Yes.
Pink.
He was the pink wizard.
No, really. What do you think?
Well, it's kind of a beigey, kind of russet, kind of reddish, earthy,
blue,
kind
of shadow blue tree.
Brown.
Brown wizard.
He's the brown wizard. He's the wizard of number two. All right, so Jack, you got 21. Right, Mike, you got 12. I got it. All right, so let's do the reveal. So Jack, or we'll start with me. I got 3 points. Yay. Mike, you got 12. And Jack, you are the big winner this week. See, you can win sometimes.
It's the first time I've ever won anything on this goddamn show.
And it took people on the other side of the world to make it happen.
Yes.
I know. Yeah. Yeah.
All right, guys. Well, I want to thank you very much for coming on and taking time out of your con to join us.
Yes, thank you.
I really, really can't say enough about your stuff. I love it. It's fantastic.
Me too.
You guys are
can't say enough.
Your work is awesome.
And Pete, I signed us up for their early access for the slaughter. So we
sounds
are.
Sounds good. So we're playing it, right? Hey, dude.
What do you think?
Mike, download that shit, print it out at work, and we'll take it to TotalCon. We'll play it at TotalCon.
We'll print it out on the government's money. No problem.
There you go. Fantastic. All right, guys.
One of the things, just we'd love to have a game of Denial with you. You sound like the sort of folks that
exactly
really
the right sort of people.
And oh, we'd so love that. We'd love that.
Excellent. Yeah. He can run it. Excellent.
All right, let's do it. Hang out.
Seriously, we'll have a game on Hangouts.
Yeah, sweet. Absolutely. No. Yeah. I'm down with it. Let's do it. All right. So
cheers,
guys. Have a great con. I'm going to run the closer. And then if you want to hang out for a second, we can talk for a second after the show. But I got to do the thing where I go. You've just enjoyed another awesome episode of the MythWits podcast. Big thanks goes out to Doc Joe, Stuart, Ray, and Pat of StoryWeaver Games. Catch us live on Twitch Mondays at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time. Jump into the chat room and ask our guests questions. If you miss our live show, you can always catch the encore episodes at YouTube/MythWits. Find us at MythWits.com. And on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Twitch, and SoundCloud as MythWits. Do the like, follow, subscribe thing wherever it's appropriate. Give us a bunch of stars and a review on iTunes. That is important, yo. Screenshot that shit, post it on our Facebook page, and I will personally send you something special. MythWits is part of our TSR podcast network. If you like us, you are bound to like the other shows on there as well. Check out tsrpn.com. MythWits is a Creative Commons product. Make sure to check out studio187.com for more cool stuff. I'm updating the website as we speak, but this weekend. but check it out. There's a lot of changes. I cranked up my blog. I'm doing a blog now of all the other things I'm doing. Anyway, thanks everybody for listening. Tell your friends to tune in. Please tell your friends to tune in. We need more listeners. And until next week, Mike?
Jack? The drop bear is a hoax. in contemporary Australian folklore.
Featuring
I knew it!
commonly spoken about in
The Aussies are taking you for a ride, mate! All right, everybody!
I knew it!
See you next week!